Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Legacy Christian Academy families, a special welcome to our eighth grade students as well. We gather on this occasion of your eighth grade promotion. My name is Mrs. Housley. I teach eighth grade English and have the opportunity to teach all of these students this year. I'm honored to lead us through tonight's eighth grade promotion. While you were waiting for the students to enter tonight, you had the opportunity to look back at how your children, this eighth grade class, has grown over the years. They have had many shared experiences that have bonded them together. No doubt the highlight was the Virginia trip. Please join me in thanking Lisa Liberis and Abby Hecht, who is one of our high school student communication interns, for their work to make that special video. At this time, I would like to introduce the head of school at Legacy Christian Academy, Mr. McGee, to welcome us and open us in prayer.
Thank you, Mrs. Housley. Good evening, friends, family members, special guests of our eighth grade class, the class of 2023. That's hard to believe. Got one piece of advice, parents, don't blink. They'll be out of your house before you know it. Before I ask God's blessing on our ceremony tonight, I just want to say a word. I want to give you one piece of advice, young men and young women of our eighth grade class. First of all, I want to tell you how proud I am of you, of your accomplishments, of how you've grown over the years, and how you so represent our school so well. And I know your teachers are very proud of you, as I am. So here's my piece of advice. You're about to move from the top of the proverbial totem pole to the bottom as freshmen. But here's my advice. Lead from the bottom up. You can lead, because leadership is not a position. Leadership is an intent, an intentional act of doing the right thing and encouraging others to do the right thing. So you can lead. You can make an influence in our upper school next year, even as freshmen. So with that, let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, I just thank you for this time to gather. As we come together in this convocation to celebrate the accomplishments of this outstanding group of students. Father, it just seems like yesterday that they were entering school. And here we are, a few years later, at this special ceremony to honor their accomplishments and to celebrate who they are and whose they are. Father, I thank you for their parents, for their grandparents, for all of their friends who have supported them on their educational journey. And I thank you for the sacrifices they have made on these children's behalf. And Father, I ask a blessing upon them as they go forward in their academic career, that you would continue to help them grow in wisdom and in stature and in favor with you and others. And so, Father, this evening, I would just ask that we be in a spirit of celebration, a spirit of worship, and a spirit of gratitude as we celebrate this major accomplishment. May all that we say and do this evening be to your honor and glory, and it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Mr. McGee. This year, we have greatly enjoyed the student-led worship during our chapel time. The worship team's leadership and example has been an encouragement to all of us. Please stand with me as we worship together.
back down again till you've lost all belief.
Thank you.
sky, canvas of your grace. The creation still obeys you, so will I. The stars were made to worship, so will I.
One of our goals at LCA is to have students understand that whenever we open God's Word, the author is present. God speaks to us through His Word. Through His Word, we are given so many great truths, so many promises, and so many words of encouragement to follow Him and be faithful to Him. Right now, I would like to invite Austin Porter to come forward and read a passage of God's scripture.
Tonight's Bible reading comes from the New International Version, and I'll be reading John 1, 24 through 34. Now the Pharisees who had been sent questioned John the Baptist, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" I baptize with water, John replied, but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. This all happened at Bethany, on the other side of the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, a man who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel. Then John gave his testimony. I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. And I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, the man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify that this is God's chosen one.
Thank you, Austin. Tonight is all about our eighth grade students and the closing of a chapter in their lives. In the coming months, they will embark on the journey through the uncharted waters of high school, college, and then the big, wide world. Who you are now is not who you were when you first started Legacy. You've grown in many ways. You've changed, you've been stretched, and you have experienced many different things. Before we close this chapter, we have a number of students who are going to give you a chance to look back on your time at Legacy. Will those students please come forward?
Good evening, and welcome to Legacy Christian Academy's 8th grade promotion. Upper school will be here before we know it. Unfortunately, we will be back at the bottom of the totem pole, losing our seniority. Before we head off to upper school, we have decided to look back at some of the memories we have made through the years. Even though we often drive each other crazy, we care for each other and begin this new adventure together. From the first day of pre-K to this year, we have made so many memories together. From a scorpion in a classroom to the current stench that can be smelled throughout the eighth grade hallway. Walk with us as we talk about some of the funniest, most memorable, and lovable times of our experience at Legacy Christian Academy.
Pre-K, a time I can't remember half of, but here's some of the very few things from pre-K that I can recall. One of the things is that we should have taken better advantage of was nap time. We eighth graders desperately want that back now. I also remember this thing about Q and U getting married, because you can't have the letter Q without a U. To a kid, hearing that letters got married was weird. Around Christmas time, the entire hallway was decorated as a winter wonderland. What was it called again? Oh right, the Arctic Blast. In pre-K, they brought a mini train to school, and we were able to ride it around the building. Anything else from a decade ago that I can remember? Ah, yes. The rule that would follow us through every art and craft we ever did. Color in between the lines. And that's it.
Kindergarten was a big year of firsts. We started off the year with our first day of big kids school. We started making our first friends, and most of us learned how to tie our shoes. We learned how to write our names and started spelling words our little brains could grasp. We practiced sight words and started reading our first books. The many projects made school fun, but who knew that the whole school thing came along with 12 more years? We started to appreciate nap time, the time that we would secretly talk to our friends. Little did we know then that we would miss this time every day for the rest of our lives. We finally got to run in laps for Legacy and have fun during field day with the big kids. We wished for homework and couldn't wait for first grade. The 100th day of school celebration came fast, and before we knew it, we were walking across the stage in our little caps and gowns at our kindergarten graduation. Then, we graduated to the number grades and couldn't wait for the following years. Thank goodness we don't have to wear those little white caps again today.
The first weeks of first grade, we were getting used to real school. Of course, usually our idea of real school isn't the teacher finding a scorpion in the children's book she was reading to us, screaming, and then throwing the book towards us. While it wasn't fun at the time, it makes for great content now. Also, at this time, we had a life-changing moment, losing teeth. Yes, we all started losing our teeth, except for me. I started losing teeth in fourth grade, but we're not here to talk about that. One day we particularly looked forward to was pet day. Most of us brought dogs and cats. I brought a gecko, but a kid named Ben Self brought his horse. He was an overachiever. Another one of those days was the invention convention. People created something that made their normal life easier. Some kids made things that helped them in a hobby. This was the period of life when many of us were addicted to Legos, so a lot of kids made things that had to do with Legos. I made a Lego vacuum, which was supposed to suck up Legos, but I realized they already made one. It was called a vacuum. One fateful day came when it was almost release time. An eerie voice came over the PA and said, "There is a tornado warning. Teachers, take your kids to your assigned emergency location." So, of course, it was entirely peaceful. No, it immediately chaos erupted. But we obviously survived.
Second grade was a very memorable year. Our fantastic teachers, Mrs. Embry, Mrs. Walsh, and Mrs. Rogers, all helped us learn lessons we would cherish for years to come, even though we didn't even know we were learning them. In second grade, we had some big changes. We read our first novel, Ribsy. We finally were able to have recess on the football field. We learned the beginning of cursive, and we also started some really hard math, borrowing when we subtracted. Second grade was the year of no worries. We practically didn't even know what the word quiz was. We also did some really fun projects. One of them was an autobiography project where we created the person we studied on a can. We then put different facts about the person inside of the can and then gave an oral presentation. Also, in second grade, we made different habitats out of shoeboxes and created poetry that we presented during the Poetry Cafe. Second grade also included a very fun field trip, going to the aquarium where we created memories that we can still remember today.
Third grade was the year that we officially became big kids. It was our first year with lockers. The girls all had their fancy carpet, chandeliers, curtains, and mirrors, but the parents of the boys had to force their children just to put shelves in. This was the year that school became school. Though we still had to have the boring classes, math, science, writing, and social studies, sorry, teachers, we still found ways to have fun. If we didn't have multiplication fact songs in third grade, I think everyone would be failing algebra right now. And let's not forget the fast fact quizzes we had, which could be very interesting given how competitive our class was. During third grade, we all participated in the Living Museum. During this event, we chose a historical person, dressed up as if we were them, and gave a speech about the events of their life. I think the best field trip we had that year didn't include anything academic. We went ice skating, which basically consisted of us falling on our faces the entire time. We had such a good time that Coach Truman said we would go every year, but we're still waiting for our next ice skating field trip. We read one of my favorite books of all time, Charlotte's Web, and we all started crying during the movie, or maybe that was just me, hopefully not. One of the most artistic projects we have ever done was during third grade. We had our Michelangelo back painting project. For this project, we were told to lay on our backs and make our own special creation based on one of Michelangelo's classic paintings. I still can't believe how a beautiful painting could look like such a monster. Overall, third grade was such a great year.
Fourth grade was a good year. For teachers, we had Ms. Pfizer, Ms. Thompson, Ms. Brubaker, who's now Ms. Butts. Ms. Pfizer taught us math and English, Ms. Thompson taught us history, and Ms. Brubaker taught us science. We went on the amazing fourth grade field trip around the best state, our own. We visited many places with historical Texan value, like the Alamo, the Capitol Building, some crazy caverns, and quite a few Texas Revolution museums. However, my favorite part was when we hung out at TBRM Ranch. The first night, I slept on a top bunk with no railing. That was a mistake. In the middle of the night, I rolled over, fell off, and obtained a line of bruises all the way across my back. It was fun. In fourth grade, we also read some books. Our favorite was Where the Red Fern Grows, for a reason we all know. Something involving the dogs. This was the last year before DEAR, which stands for Drop Everything and Read. When we had bad weather when we were younger, we would stay inside and play board games and Legos. We previously loved it when it rained, until DEAR replaced indoor recess, making this the best year for rambunctious children like us. However, there were some rather unfathomable curricular activities. Penmanship booklets, for example. Though those value of these booklets did not carry on to nowadays, because my handwriting is still absolute garbage. On the other hand, we did some enjoyable activities too. There was a rotation of eager fourth graders foaming at the mouth to be featured on the week's Good Morning Legacy. All of the fourth grade classrooms would freeze every week to watch it. There were lots of funny parts on the show, and we learned some things from them too. This was the year I decided to read the Rick Riordan Percy Jackson series, and I picked a good time. We learned about Greek mythology, and I thought I could teach the class. We went on another field trip as well, the fake geocaching field trip, which was when you hunted for a hidden object by using GPS coordinates posted on a website or an app. I'm pretty sure our coordinates were wrong because we kept ending up at some abandoned playground. In the end, we ended up at the right place.
Fifth grade was year first. It was our first year of middle school where we were taught to be more independent in our work and how we acted. It was also our first year of IXL, the math program that nobody liked because of how it bumped you down a lot of points when you got just one question incorrect. We additionally got to experience different fine arts such as band, where we got to rotate instruments, art, and choir, where Mrs. Cunningham taught us how to sing O treble clef. In language arts, we learned the preposition song from Mrs. Lowe. We also read different novels and made book trailers that went along with them. And it was the beginning of the unfortunate learning to diagram. And let's not forget the experience of having to sit in that dark room with our teachers to watch the dreaded puberty video. At the closing of the year, we did a talent show on the last day of school, where everyone did one act in order to participate. Some were interesting than others. Overall, fifth grade was an amazing start to middle school, and by the end of the year, we are ready to proceed on the long but much worth it journey of adventures and new experiences.
Sixth grade, the most awkward stage of our lives, at least up to that point. There were no photos that any of us would actually be proud of, but sixth grade was fun. We were introduced to the concept of homework and realized that stress was a real thing. We had many new amazing teachers, Mrs. Watts, the math teacher who brought popcorn, Mrs. Blue, the witty science teacher, and Mrs. Lamsey, the comforting English teacher, and Dr. Dorsey, the jokester of them all. Mrs. Blue turned us into water molecules and reminded us to watch out. Felix, the classroom turtle, was on the move. He lacked potty training skills and didn't seem to mind leaving messes for the rest of us to pick up. We had many fun and educational projects, including the Holocaust Project, the Cat Project, and the Bible Video Project. With the girls and boys separated for Bible class, we went around the school making videos to go with our memory verses for that year. A significant portion of English consisted of the Holocaust Project and of grammar. We read The Giver and The Hiding Place, but academic things were not the only things going on in the classroom. In the desks, you would find kids playing with fidget spinners, and we will never forget Ava Love's Black Market for Slime. At $3 per slime, no one could say no. Those weren't our only sixth grade obsessions. We also told ourselves that silly bands were cool, and that water bottle flipping wasn't annoying. The best part of sixth grade, though, was Sky Ranch. We'll never forget the memories of our own skits, but especially our teacher's skits, with Dr. Dorsey playing the student who wouldn't stop flipping the water bottle, Mr. Dibley playing the one who had to go to the bathroom, and Mrs. Watts playing the good kid. We all know that that was their message to us. We needed to shape up, and we could get pretty annoying. Sixth grade was filled with many ups and downs, from picking our fine arts to making kites. It may have been hard at the time, but we made memories we will have for the rest of our lives.
So
Seventh grade was definitely a big change that came with much more responsibility. We started switching classes, participated in dissections, and were constantly called young adults. And we also read our first ever Shakespearean play. Seventh grade also came along with being called Sevies by the eighth graders, and we were introduced to the whole idea of seniority. As a group, we definitely began a phase of rebellion. For example, the Alex payments. This year had also a very exciting time in store for us, the time when school closed down for a week because of the flu. Seventh grade was also a year of great, memorable teachers who definitely kept things interesting. We had Miss Ansel 101s, Jeff, Miss Thomas's diffuser, or more commonly known as vape machine, Miss Johnson's snakes, Miss Buell's treasure box, and Mr. Martin's sarcasm. In seventh grade, we were also introduced to the whole idea of flex packets, Alex, finals, ego elective, and trailblazers. We had the opportunity to try out for sports teams and had to learn how to manage our time well, which often resulted in late grades as we were still figuring this out. Seventh grade was full of fun memories we'll take with us to the upper school. Though we might have been called young adults, we still acted like children. For example, no matter how many times we were told to keep the girls' locker hallway clean, we were never completely able to, which resulted in binders being sent to the front office. This year definitely made us miss the comforts of lower school, but in the end prepared us very well for eighth grade.
Eighth grade, our last year of middle school and our first year of being treated like young adults, although we may not have always acted like young adults. This year, we did so many fun things. This year in English, we read two very interesting books and plays, one being Romeo and Juliet. During the study of this Shakespearean piece, we memorized the prologue, which we all know by heart. When one person begins reciting it, the whole grade recites with them. We also read To Kill a Mockingbird, which I think we can all agree was a tad bit more interesting than Romeo and Juliet. English class this year also included the biography project, which was enjoyable to many. We studied an influential person, made U-books, and presented them. In science, we did many awesome experiments and projects, one of these being the box project. Honor Science made tiny houses out of boxes, and On Level made marbled racetracks, where everyone competed to have the slowest race time. This year, we also made Rube Goldberg projects, where we made cool machines which completed a skill, like how to make lemonade or how to kick off summer. History this year included the very stressful Titan paper, or at least it was at the time, where we wrote about the influences Rockefeller, Vanderbilt, Carnegie, and Morgan during the Industrial Age. We also made trifolds about the Cold War era novel, Breaking Stalin's Nose. Each student in class was assigned a few chapters to read and write about. Later on, we presented them in order and were able to figure out what happened before and after our own chapters. In Bible, we learned how to defend Christianity and how to evangelize. Math included lots of sarcasm and dry humor from Ms. Beck. In class, everyone competed to pass out papers to receive a sticker, because if you got 10 stickers, you received an Alex pass. In math, we learned many useful skills that we know we will need for upper school. This year included the long-awaited Virginia trip. We visited Jamestown, Williamsburg, Yorktown, Mount Vernon, Monticello, the White House, Lincoln Memorial, and so much more. The trip included lots of logs, MAGA hats, and fried chicken. Towards the end of this year, a strange smell arose. It came from some of the eighth grade boys' lockers. And let me tell you, it stunk. As we go into the upper school, we hope the smell won't follow us. We had so many fun adventures and have made so many great memories from our years in the lower school. We have taken our last steps in middle school and are about to take our first steps in the upper school. Eighth graders, we made it! I know that we are all so excited to move up, and I know that we will make many more great memories.
It has been so exciting for the girls to get to play sports for Legacy this year. We have made so many good memories. Our coaches were definitely not afraid to kick our rear ends in conditioning this year. Along with the other sports, volleyball athletes remember having lots of conditioning. This year has also seemed to be the year of rain in our LCA sports world. Our first middle school football game got rained out, the big homecoming game also got canceled and then rescheduled, and the middle school cheerleaders' only away game that we had the opportunity to attend got rained out. And this is just to name a few. Our first day of track was freezing cold and pouring rain the entire time, but that definitely did not stop the coaches from giving us a great first practice to start off a great first year. That practice is where we all learned Eagles ready, only to expect a response back of yes, sir. Lucky for track, our practice was right after school, but for most sports, that was not the case, such as swim, who had to be there by 6:15 in the morning. Most people remember the early morning practices of their sports, but sometimes the coaches would help us out a little, like when the basketball coaches sometimes brought donuts. Sports have been a great way for us to make friends and bond with each other along the way. The girls' soccer team remembers having fun watching the boys' soccer games after theirs had ended. We've had so many fun times this year, and we give a big thank you to all the amazing LCA coaches. You have all been a major part of our year. Thank you so much for all the time you have invested into each and every Legacy athlete.
Sports are a big part of many eighth grade boys' year. Even though we sacrifice time with friends, family, and studying, most of us wouldn't trade sports for anything. This year has been amazing for us. We are blessed with multiple new coaches, including Coach Smith, Coach Gregory, Coach Allen, Coach Williams, and a returning coach, Coach Hall. Sports also had a bunch of hilarious moments. Some basketball boys pranked some others by telling them they took a private jet to a game. A few kids accidentally trucked Coach Smith during a football drill. Our football coaches also had some funny moments. Coach Smith always has voice cracks, which makes us laugh because we have them. And Coach Gregory, another one of our football coaches, drives a Chevy Tahoe, which he's obsessed with, and always talks about his car. I still don't get why he drives a soccer mom car. And our basketball coach, which I don't know why, but he owns every pair of shoes. We also learned a lot from our amazing coaches, like Eagles Ready. Sports also had many adventures, from freezing cold rained out games to bus rides filled with hyper kids and Gatorade. Don't get me started. Sports also presented times to become closer to God. Every day, we would pray before sports, and this helped us develop a tighter relationship with God and each other. Sports really are important and help many of us to find a passion and become more proper, respectful young men.
Miss Mayberry, from being a principal to an art teacher, she has been with the school since the very beginning. She can silence an entire room with just a ring of her wind chimes. She has been the best art teacher we have ever had. With each project, we learn something new. From the fundamentals of art to learning how to use a box cutter correctly without getting a RINWEB notice. The projects we did start out small, beginning with a name tag, and grew larger, like making a mini house with 500 square feet. Other projects we did were creating Zintagel cathedrals with Sharpies and graphite, making pottery 1 week, and then weaving with wires in the pottery the next. Drawing old master's artwork recreating it into a newer style, a pop-out unit, like creating an entire piece with only black paper and a white gel pen, and so many, many more. One of our favorite projects was the modern art unit. Most kids didn't have to try, which was a relief and breath of fresh air. Surprisingly, in the celebrating art competition, all of our artworks got published, and we became first for the best art studio in the United States and Canada. The biggest thing that we will miss is all the fun moments we had in art class. Miss Mayberry, on behalf of the eighth grade art students, a small paragraph cannot do you justice. From all the heartfelt talks you had with us and treating us like your own children to training us with all the iniquities of being a good artist, you have helped us grow and mature both as artists and as people. Thank you. We will remember you as a wonderful, talented, selfless woman.
In 7th and 8th grade choir, we put on multiple concerts, competed in competitions, learned songs in various languages, and went on a trip to Houston. In preparation for concerts, we learned choreography for Disney Friendship Medley, We Know the Way, and We're All in This Together. In our 7th grade spring performance, a person's shoe fell off. From that experience, we learned that the show must always go on. On our trip to Houston, we visited the mall, messed around in Bucky's, stayed in a hotel with our friends, and performed at ACSI. The choir members have sung songs in Latin, Swahili, and Polynesian. We couldn't have accomplished any of this without our amazing choir teacher, Mrs. Rodriguez. We will all miss her charts of how close she is to losing her patience before concerts, her funny things she does while directing to make us not be a zombie choir, and the girls will forever be grateful for the dresses she picked out that we can actually move our arms in. Mrs. Rodriguez, you always add so much personality to choir class and concerts. You make the best out of every situation, even if that includes telling us to just go with it and act like we know what we are doing. Thank you for all of the lessons and memorable moments you have given us over the past years.
In 7th and 8th grade drama, we had so many fun activities and opportunities. For instance, we participated in plays in the spring and the fall. This year, the middle school drama department put on their very own play called Wagon Wheels A-Rollin'. We also had a chance to participate in school productions throughout the years, such as Seussical, Cheaper by the Dozen, Peter Pan, Snow White, and Little Women. We also played many improv games, like Pan Right, Pan Left, an improv game where we play with different scenes on stage, Taxi Cab, a fun game where four people get into a taxi cab and they improv a scene, and What Are You Doing? Not only did we learn about performing on stage, but we also learned about the behind the scenes of acting. We learned costume, prop, and set design, and we learned about directing in drama. In drama, we learned performance skills while working on our confidence, which will all help us in the future.
Foreign languages were full of exciting events and projects this year, from the Pater Noster and the interactive notebook in Latin to creating picture books and song projects in Spanish. Whether you were in Latin or Spanish, everyone will agree that foreign languages are full of memories that we will never forget. People in Latin will remember the fun times from Quiz It Live, screaming and shouting for our teammates to click the right answers. This leads to some harmless competition between teams. And the people in Spanish will remember the fun times from creating the picture books for the people in pre-K. Latin people will also remember making volcanoes to learn about Pompeii and adding to our interactive notebooks from previous years. In addition, both our Latin feasts and Spanish fiestas were great. Every year, we picked a date to bring food from either the Mediterranean or the Spanish cultures for a day of eating and talking with friends. Thank you to Ms. Buell and Ms. Peterball for bringing our knowledge about these foreign languages to expand wider.
Band has been great over the years. We have been involved. Many of us began participating in fourth grade. In fourth grade, we learned the basics of music and started to play recorders and played at a recorder concert. In fifth grade, we did our fine arts rotation. Obviously, for those of us who liked instruments, the favorite rotation was band. Mr. Murphy assigned us to instruments. We always follow his Yoda-ish words, "You don't choose the instrument chooses you." In sixth grade, we started to play real band instruments. We had a scare in seventh grade when Miss Webb tripped off the stage at the Christmas concert. She immediately stood up, brushed off, stood right back up, and took a bow. After the Christmas concert, we started to get ready for our contest in March. At the contest, we received perfect scores and afterwards went to the Galleria Mall to go ice skating. Then in eighth grade, we played at a Christmas concert. At our spring contest this year, we again received perfect scores from all the judges. To finish out this year, we played our end of the year concert where many received awards and Mr. Murphy received an infinity gauntlet.
One thing we have been able to enjoy at Legacy is our mission projects. While on the mission trip to Houston this year, we learned two important things. The missions work is very rewarding and that it can also be very fun. On the last night of the missions trip, we went to an amusement park at the world's second largest rodeo. In LSO, or Legacy Service Organization, our students did things like clean the toys of our preschoolers or any other tasks that teachers needed done. We also helped pack 226,665 meals in the upper school gym for Feed My Starving Children while dancing to some sick 80s tunes. Afterwards, we participated in Laps of Love, our 5K to raise money to pay for the shipment to Haiti for all the meals we had packed. At Legacy, a tradition of mission is encouraged, and we look forward to continuing to participate in the upper school. I am also here to thank some very important people to our education, our parents. Thank you so much for helping us with homework, from packets to projects to last-minute trips to FedEx to getting us to 6 a.m. practices. You've supported us and encouraged us from pre-K to 8th grade. Thank you, parents.
Thank you, students. It's amazing what you remember all those years ago. And as a teacher, as funny as it is, all those things that you remember, it could actually be a little discouraging I mean, as a teacher, you pour your blood, sweat, and tears every day into trying to communicate knowledge and trying to teach important concepts and principles, and you do everything you can to help you remember and help you learn. And what do you remember? You remember things like Lego vacuums, losing front teeth, and all kinds of field trips. What you remember are experiences. What you remember are people. You remember things that went really well, and you remember things that went really badly, like falling off the bunk on the fourth grade trip. You remember the people you were with and the time spent together. But as a teacher, when you teach a lesson, you're hoping that the students will all be on board, and you're hoping that they will be tracking with you in every, and hang on, every word that you're saying. And the way that you know as a teacher if they're tracking with you is by the questions that they ask. Mr. Martin, what do you think Jesus meant when he said? Mrs. Gussman, what do you think would happen if we did this? Mrs. Beck, what would it look like if we tried to solve a problem this way? As a teacher, you absolutely live for those moments. And they might be few and far between, but we live for those moments. So I recently polled the teachers and I asked them for the questions that are most commonly asked by students. Here's what they got back to me with. Students, I won't embarrass you. You might embarrass yourself. But think about if you have asked any of these questions. Do you have any pencils? Is this for a grade? I was absent yesterday. Did I miss anything? Can I go see Dr. Sneer? That was the teachers asking that question. How many more years do we have to do grammar? What period is it right now? Are we doing anything today? I know I turned in a paper an hour ago that was 3 weeks late, but have you graded it yet? Oh, there's more. Can we listen to music? My mom says I need to make an A. What should I do? Mom, you know who you are. Is there any extra credit I can do to raise my grade? Can I go to the nurse? Can I have a Band-Aid for this tiny paper cut on my finger? Can we get a moving sidewalk installed in the 7th and 8th grade hallway so we don't have to walk as much? Okay, who asked that question? It was one of you. So I have to stop right here. Think about what your teachers have to put up with. 8th grade, you need to show your teacher some love right now and say thank you. So, we've all heard that there's no such thing as a dumb question. But we all know that's not true. There are some really dumb questions out there. So, here are some of the dumbest questions asked on Yahoo. Are 60 seconds and 1 minute the same? Can I safely look at a picture of the sun? Is the Hunger Games based on a true story? Can I actually lose weight by rubbing my stomach? Some of you are sitting there right now. What happens if you paint your teeth white with nail polish? Is that bad for you? Do you think humans will ever walk on the sun? And there's a follow-up question. I mean, I know it's really hot, but what if you did it in winter, like when it was 30 degrees? If I ate myself, would I become twice as big or would I disappear? So clearly, there are some dumb questions. But here's the truth. If you ask a question, you might look dumb for 5 minutes. But if you don't ask a question, you could look dumb for 50 years. If you don't ask the question, can I safely look at a picture of the sun? You might look dumb for a few minutes. But if you don't ask the question, you're going to be afraid your whole life that you'll see a picture of the sun and you'll go blind. So, always ask questions in your life. Questions are good things. Without questions, you will not get answers. As I was thinking about this idea of asking questions, I was wondering if Jesus was ever asked any dumb questions. Jesus was a teacher. His disciples were his students. I bet there were some dumb questions that they asked, but they didn't write down because they realized how dumb it would make them look. Jesus is teaching his parables. Peter's been out fishing. He comes in late. Sorry, I'm late. Did I miss anything? No, Peter, we didn't do anything while you were gone. Just, you're fine. Andrew speaks up. Jesus, do you have any pencils? I lost mine. And like Mrs. Housley, Jesus just points to the pencil box. Judas says, is there any extra credit I can do to raise my grade? And Jesus, like Mrs. Bales, just shakes her head and thinks, just do it right the first time. Questions are important to ask. If you don't ask, you may never know. And people ask Jesus lots of questions. So I wonder, what's the most important question that Jesus was ever asked? Some questions are more important than others. Some were asked out of pure motives, and others were asked out of a trap, desire to trap Jesus. So there's some questions on the screen. Jesus, why don't your disciples wash their hands? Is it right to pay taxes to Caesar? What is the greatest commandment? Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And what good deed must I do to inherit eternal life? All kinds of questions. This is just a few. Good questions, but what's the most important question? To answer this question, I want to go back to a time before Jesus was born. Mary is pregnant. She's got the message from the angel that she's going to give birth to Jesus. And Mary has a relative, and her name is Elizabeth. And Elizabeth, in her own miraculous way, is pregnant. She's pregnant with John the Baptist. We have Mary and Elizabeth and their relatives, and they're going to give birth to Jesus, and they're going to give birth to John the Baptist. Now, we don't know how much time they spent together growing up, once a year, once every few years, every now and again. But by the time they were about 30 years old, John is baptizing in the Jordan River. And this is what Austin read for us earlier. And when John sees Jesus, he says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." John is saying, that's him. He's right there. And John baptizes Jesus, and he sees the Holy Spirit descend on him, and then he declares, "I have seen and testify that this is the Son of God." John gets it. He knows who Jesus is. He's seen the Holy Spirit, and he knows that Jesus has come from God. Fast forward some time later. John is in prison. He was put there for speaking truth about calling out sin in a government official's life. And John knew he was in trouble. He probably knew that he wasn't going to get out of there. And while he's in that jail cell, everything looks bleak. His life circumstances have taken a turn that he did not see coming. But at the same time, he hears what Jesus is doing. He knows that Jesus is out there and Jesus is performing miracles. He knows that Jesus is teaching about God. And so John sends his disciples to Jesus to ask one question. So in Matthew 11, it says, when John, who was in prison, heard about the deeds of the Messiah, he sent his disciples to him. Are you the one who is to come? Or should we expect someone else? There's the question. Are you the one? Are you the Lamb of God that I proclaimed that you were? Are you the Son of God? Jesus, are you who you say you are? Because I need to know right now in this moment. I'm going down, and for one last time before I leave this earth, Jesus, I need to know, are you the one? Are you the one who's going to carry me to the other side when this life is done? The question is, Jesus, are you the one? Now, Jesus, being Jesus, is not surprised by the question. But how might Jesus have reacted? John, how can you ask such a question? You were there when I was baptized. You heard my Father's voice from heaven. Our mothers told the same story about our miraculous birth. John, you of all people should know better than to ask that question. John, if you don't know that I'm the one, then how can I expect anybody else to believe that I'm the one? John, you're supposed to be setting an example for others. I'm really disappointed in you, John. You should know better. John is asking the question, are you the one? Jesus isn't fazed, and he's not shocked. In his mind, he sees John in the prison cell. He recalls the day of his baptism, and he was so proud of John. He thinks about John announcing to the world, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And he thinks about how John has been pointing other people towards God. He's been thinking about the sacrifices that John has made in his own life. He thinks about their friendship. And he thinks about John sitting there in that cell, and Jesus wants to give him something that he can count on. Something he can take to his grave. Something so that John will never have to ask that question again. Jesus replied, go back and report to John what you hear and see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is proclaimed to the poor. Blessed is anyone who does not stumble on account of me. Jesus says, John, look what's happening. Look at the lives being changed. People's hearts being turned to God. People being set free from their sin. It was a resounding yes from Jesus. I am the one. You don't need to look any further. Jesus is saying, John, I've got you. I'm not mad at you or your question. I'm not shocked. I'm not disappointed. I can handle it, John, but know this. The blind receive their sight. The lame walk. The lepers are cured. The deaf can hear. And the dead are raised to life. And the good news is proclaimed to the poor. Jesus says, I am the one who will be with you and will take care of you in this life, and I will be the one who will carry you to the other side. John, I am the one. It wasn't long after that that John's life was taken from him. But as he went to his death, he didn't have to wonder anymore. You are in eighth grade, and you don't have all the answers. You have a lot of questions. Whatever your questions are, it's okay to ask Jesus. He can handle it. There are going to be things that happen in this life that you do not understand, and Jesus can handle your questions. For those of us who are not in eighth grade tonight, there are going to be times of stress and struggle and heartbreak and disillusionment. Life can be plain hard. Jesus can handle your questions. And in life, you don't always get the answers you want. And there are going to be different things that you wonder, why didn't they turn out differently? You're not going to get all the answers to all of your questions. But the most important question you can ask is, Jesus, are you the one? And his answer to that question is the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cured, the deaf can hear, and the dead are raised. I am the one who will carry you to the other side. I will be with you in this life. If you can answer that question, Jesus, of Jesus being the one, if you can settle that question in your mind, it will guide you every step of the way in your life. It will help you decide on the toughest questions and the toughest decisions, and it will help you when life goes a direction that you didn't see coming. You've asked a lot of questions through middle school. You've asked some questions that we wish you didn't ask. But our hope for you is that you have asked this question, Jesus, are you the one? And that you've decided to follow him every day going forward. In a moment, just like we practiced, you're going to walk across this stage. And I don't want it to be just a walk. I want it to be a stake in the ground declaration moment that you've answered the question, Jesus, you are the one. And with every step, I want you to be thinking about the question that was asked to John, Jesus, are you the one? And with every step, the blind receive their sight. The lame walk. The lepers are cured. The deaf hear. The dead are raised to life. And as you walk across the stage and you shake hands, it's your affirmation of your faith in Jesus that he's the one. I can't force it to be that walk for you tonight, but I would love for you as you walk across that stage to be thinking, yes, Jesus, you are the one. In a few moments, you're going to be released from our care as teachers, and we're going to send you forward with blessing into the upper school. And I hope you drive the upper school teachers crazy with the same ridiculous questions. But make sure you've asked the most important question, Jesus, are you the one? And no matter where life takes you, nothing would make us prouder than to see you living a life that demonstrates that you've answered that question. Eighth grade, it's been fun, it's been real. Eighth grade, may God bless each one of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dibley. In a few minutes, each eighth grade student is going to come up to the stage and receive a promotion packet that contains a promotion certificate, a photo of your class from the Virginia trip, and some letters from teachers, parents, and grandparents that have been prepared for you to speak into your life. We hope this is meaningful to you. At this time, I'd like to invite Mr. McGee back up on stage. Eighth grade, congratulations on your completion of intermediate school. It has been a blessing getting to know you, and we, your teachers, look forward to seeing you achieve all that God has planned for you. On behalf of Mr. McGee, Mr. Dibley, and all your teachers, having met the requirements for middle school, it gives me great pleasure to promote you to ninth grade. Will the first section of students come take your position? Families and friends, I present to you the following students who have successfully completed the requirements for eighth grade at Legacy Christian Academy. Hannah Abink. Ava Anderson. Ollie Ainsley. Penelope Atkins. Allie Acock. Peyton Banks. Nash Blaze. Julia Brown. Catherine Chambers. Luke Chambers. Maggie Chandler. Cooper Coleman. Peyton Ivy Collins. Cash Cooper. Jack Crabb. Sam Crabb. Braden Colonel. D'Agostino. Andrew Darrell. Emily Dean. Zach Disatel. May we please have the next group of students approach the stage? Gracie Dreger. Matthew Early. Audrey Edwards. Eric Erickson. Abby Gleason. Ava Love Goplin. Grace Hamilton. Jacob Hamilton. Jack Haynes. Luke Haynes. Trace Harris. Nick Hecht. Sam Hecht. Tyler Henley. Jacob Hill. Job Holt. The next group of students may approach the stage. Deanna Horton. Molly Housley. Jack Jordan. Taylor Knott. Brady Laramie. Ethan Lazaro. Priscilla Liberis. Madeline Lucas. Nathan Lee. Grant Martinez. Nathan McBroom. Will Maida. Jared Nguyen. Carlisle Noble. Ethan Norris. Our next group of students may come to the stage. Tristan Phillips. Presley Kate Pittard. Cortland Plunk. Austin Porter. Tiffany Pranato. Andrew Prasanna. Mark Purvis. Mackenzie Rideout. Nicholas Robison. Anna Rodman. Dylan Rogers. Zachary Rowley. Amelie Rendell. Madison Shaw. The final group of students may take your place. Piper Siddons. Savannah Simmons. Brock Sims. Christian Syracuse. Savannah Skidmore. Stephen Slattery. Callie Snyder. Whitney Sanju. Heidi Taunton. Emma Taylor. Lexi Toot. Mackenzie Tullis. Kaiser Walters. Keegan Wexler. In Williams. And Victoria Winkler. Eighth graders, you can return to your seats. At this time, I would like to ask the eighth grade class to please stand. Coach Roach, if you could make your way up here. He's going to come forward and pray a blessing over our eighth grade students.
Eighth graders, so very proud of you. Congratulations. Well, that's right. You're ninth graders. That's awesome. And you already look older. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we are so grateful for your love, mercy, and grace. Thank you for Jesus who died to save us. Father, thank you that you sent the one, and his name was Jesus, and that by trusting in him, we have life eternal. Thanks to his death on the cross, his burial, and his glorious resurrection from the grave, we have hope tonight for eternal life, that this isn't all there is, but Father, we have a future in heaven for you. So, Father, let us live today victoriously because you have already won the victory for us through Jesus Christ our Lord. And it is his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Ninth graders. Thank you for your attendance and making this a memorable experience for your children. In a moment, the eighth grade, now ninth grade, will exit. After they do, please join us for a short reception in the student commons. Friends and family, I present to you the class of 2023.
So bring your good times and your laughter too. We gon' sing.